Dan is the fifth president of the Metropolitan Museum. It's really a great pleasure to be able to interview you here. Dan will actually give you a bit of perspective about the museum, but it has about 2 million objects, over 5,000 years of history, 7 million visitors, and that number keeps on increasing, which itself is fascinating given technology, and an operating budget of 320 million. How do you prioritize all the things the museum wants to do and has to do?
Our mission is to collect, exhibit, study, educate around the cultural history of human civilization. And we are one of the only institutions in the world with a purview that broad. The Met has a very special, I think, complicated relationship to the world. It is a beloved local institution, and I'm sure many of you can tell stories about your own relationship to the Met and your lifetime experience of attending and visiting. And for many people, it's a very special local institution that's been part of their lives. But it also is a global institution that does a great deal more than just collect and exhibit art. We are one of the most important and powerful cultural institutions in the world. So our collections, we often talk about 5,000 years of cultural history, but actually culture, if one looks at human history, it was about 5,000 years ago that people started to learn how to write and create organized civilizations, but we actually have art going back a lot earlier than that. So our mandate is to do justice to that extraordinary responsibility. The world is changing in all kinds of ways, and we can talk about that, about what audiences are looking for and how people think about culture and what do they want in an art museum anyway. But it's important to start with who we are and what makes us distinctive in how we contribute to the world. Our goal is to provide an opportunity for people to have meaningful experiences with art in the building, and that can be played out in a whole host of different ways.
How is technology playing a role, especially if people can access the great website you have? They can look at all the pictures, they can study, they can read.
We really use technology in two ways at the Met, and it's not all that different from any cultural institution. On the one hand, we use technology to help facilitate visits. That's one thing. The other thing we do is we feel that we have a very important responsibility as a global cultural center to be able to provide art historical content and mission-related material to people around the world who may never come to the Met. And we have 32 million hits to our website a year, and many of those people will never come to the Met. These are school children in Pakistan. We have video content. We have all kinds of things that are meaningful to people that have nothing to do with being in the building. There was a time when there was great concern that as digital technologies became increasingly sophisticated and the quality of images we could produce was so high, that why bother going to see the object? But we began this discussion by pointing out that we had 7 million visitors this year, which is a record. And it doesn't work that way. The more people engage with digital content, the more interested they are in the real thing.
You've mentioned a cultural institution preserving so many artifacts, but one of the big controversial issues that has come up is so many countries now ask for their art back. So how do you balance that, knowing that the likelihood of things being preserved in the museum are much greater than if they're somewhere in, let's say, ISIS territory?
Well, our mission is, again, object-centered. So our curators and our conservators and our professional staff have a passion for collecting and, even more important, protecting the works of art that define the human condition. And so what's been going on in the Middle East and what ISIS has been doing has been extraordinarily painful for us because there's only so much that we can do about that. Our job, once works of art are in our possession, is to treat them, as I said, with care and the highest level of professional acumen to make sure that they're being treated in a way that allows them to be preserved forever. We live in a world that obviously is governed by laws that are not set by the Metropolitan Museum of Art. So we can't decide what we're going to collect or give back based on what we think is just what we decide. We operate with respect for the law, with the highest professional standards as set by our industry, and with integrity.
One of the big controversial issues these days is what to do with some of the monuments in the US. You all know about the whole Civil War monuments and people wanting them removed. On the other hand, it's part of American history, and should one keep them? How do you think about that? How should people view this debate that's ongoing and people want to react to it?
Well, I think the most interesting part of the question is really about how we as a free society structure the debate. There is no right answer to the question. works of art that are put up in public spaces to honor people who are at one time seen as laudable and at another time seen as egregious is a movable question. And we can all problematize famous people in history around these questions. And, you know, we've done that. I don't know that there is, so I don't have a ready answer except a quick reaction to removing works of art because they're offending some number of people is not the right answer. There needs to be a much more thoughtful discussion. And I would say as a former educator and in my job today, my greatest concern is that we are increasingly moving as a society away from having the capacity for meaningful disagreement and discussion. Debate in the most thoughtful way, where people can have very thoughtful, heated disagreement on difficult issues and maintain the ability to function as human beings at the same time. It's increasingly obvious that we don't know how to do that. We're not doing it on college campuses. We're not doing it in Congress. We're not doing it in the court of public opinion on these issues. So the question about monuments should, in my view, live in that space. What should a community do if an issue is raised about a statue of Robert E. Lee, for example, or some other person? I think sometimes it is worthwhile to remove the object. Sometimes it's worthwhile to label the object. This work of art was put in place in 1905 for this reason under these circumstances, so that people understand the historical meaning of that object. But if all we're doing all the time is revising history and our own representation of ourselves based on how we feel at the moment, we will lose sight of who we are and where we come from. And again, the really hard thing to do is how do we figure out how to have hard conversations about what matters? And I don't have an obvious answer to that, but it's a concern.
If we were to extend the debate into what's happening on college campuses, you've been president of two colleges, how do people think about this debate?
My own bias is that we should go as far as we possibly can to engage free speech, to tolerate, to support, to invite it. And there is a line. There are times when freedom of speech migrates into something that's dangerous or threatening. And when that happens, one has to be very clear about what those boundaries are. But if someone is going to come and preach the destruction of communities or to say or do something that is genuinely seen as a threat, one needs to draw the line. But beyond that, I wouldn't. And so I think what educational institutions should focus on first and foremost are the skills that it takes to have those kinds of discussions. If someone's coming onto your college campus who is going to espouse a point of view that you find egregious, then you have the option not to go. Or you can show up and debate them. There are lots of ways to engage that issue. But increasingly, I've seen on college campuses the concern that people don't feel comfortable being accosted by ideas that feel threatening to them, that undermine their own sense of themselves or their own sense of what they see justice to look like. And I don't think valuable learning comes that way. So in some ways, one might turn that discussion around entirely and say that good learning takes place explicitly when people are uncomfortable. So if all we're doing is seeking safe spaces to keep people comfortable, they're not likely to grow and extend themselves in ways that's most helpful. So as a college president or as a university professor or whatever, I would always try to create that kind of space. And it's very difficult to do because it can touch on deep emotional issues for people as well. But the line of acceptable free speech should be drawn very, very carefully.
When you look forward, what are you most optimistic about? What are you concerned about? What worries you? What keeps you up at night?
Well, as a museum professional, I'm very heartened by the fact that interest in what we do continues to grow, and that whatever the challenges are that the world around us bring, people seem drawn for all kinds of reasons, as we've mentioned, to want to be connected to what the Metropolitan Museum of Art has to offer. And it's very heartening to be in an institution that you believe in so deeply that inspires my life and to know that it's so meaningful to other people. One could imagine a very different proposition where your struggle is everybody, like, how do we get people in this place? How do we get them to care about what we're doing? That's not an issue for us. So I'm very heartened by the fact that there's something very fundamental in all of us that really cares about these things, because these things matter. They matter a great deal. And as I think about that then, how do we activate that mission in the 21st century in a way that engages people who are changing all the time, who live in a world that is completely buffeted by technology and all the things that we've mentioned. So how do we continue to redeploy our mission in ways that's relevant to the world around? But it's enormously exciting to be part of an enterprise that has that kind of mandate and that kind of opportunity. Beyond our museum, and if I look around our nation and the world, it's a very troubling time. And it is, in some ways, very disturbing to me that so much of it is just completely self-imposed, that as a civilization, there are so many things we could do better if we had greater accountability for our own leadership, greater attentiveness to our own core responsibilities. And I'm hoping there's going to be more of a grassroots movement than maybe the generation that follows ours that will do a better job than my generation has done. But it isn't the most heartening time to look around and be proud of what we've accomplished as a nation or as a world in light of what we might accomplish. So I worry about that. But every day I get to go to the Metropolitan Museum of Art and feel very good about it.
Feel good about that. What is the best one or two pieces of advice you would give?
As a leader, you should not worry and be preoccupied with making mistakes. You will make them. Indeed, you will make lots of them. It's a little bit like baseball and a batting average. The question is, are you making decisions with integrity in a thoughtful way, and are you owning your mistakes when you make them? And if you own them and you're generous about acknowledging that you've made those mistakes, people are more often than not inclined to forgive you. And I found that to be absolutely the case in my career. I'm not preoccupied with making mistakes. And so I make decisions in a thoughtful way, and I'm as consultative as I can be. But I recognize that life is an iterative process, and we're going to learn as we go. So not being preoccupied with avoiding criticism, but to be open to it and to be willing to make mistakes. And if, again, one takes the long view of history, if you walk through the Met and get a sense for all the times and places we could have lived, we can do more with this moment if we take advantage of that, even in our own little way, by making our own little world a little bit better. So just to be a bit more self-conscious, perhaps, about our extraordinary good fortune. And nobody is in this room because you're brilliant. You're in this room because you're lucky and you're brilliant. And it comes second. I think that's an important observation.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure. Thank you all. Great to be here.